Good evening. Welcome to the August 10th, 2016 meeting of the Washington Township Healthcare District Board of Directors. If you would rise with me for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Christine, if you could call the roll.
Director Nicholson.
Present.
Director Stewart.
Present.
Director Danielson.
Present.
Director Ethan.
Present.
And Director Wallace is away.
Thank you. We have an education session tonight, and that's going to be the Washington Hospital Employees Association, presented by their president, Christy Caracappa. Nancy, do you have any introduction for?
Well, yes, I sure do. Well,
then absolutely. She's got great credentials.
She's our Health Insurance Information Service Coordinator. She's held this position since 2009. She provides information to community members to assist them with making informed decisions regarding health care coverage. Christy is the Washington Hospital Employee Association president. This is her second year as president. Previously, Christy held the WHEA board position of vice president and treasurer. She moved from the South Bay to Fremont 43 years ago. She enjoys serving the community members of Washington Township District where she and her family reside. Christy?
Thank you, Nancy, and thank you, everybody, for having us here tonight to talk a little bit about the Washington Employee Association, Washington Hospital Employee Association, otherwise known as WHEA. This is our logo we came up with a couple years ago. I think it expresses what we're all about, which is having fun. There's two employees there sliding down an unauthorized slide. I'm sure there's padding at the bottom and they're wearing helmets, but let's just imagine that. So I'd like to tell you that we were founded in, I just found this out, we were founded in 1971. So 45 years ago, we were founded to foster good community relations and support hospital programs and services. We are officers and board members. We have four elected officers, the president, vice president, secretary, and treasurer. And we have our appointed membership registrar and our administrative advisor, Angus Cochran, appointed by the chief executive officer, Nancy. So who are WHEA members? WHEA members are anybody at the hospital that is an employee. Excuse me, if you're an employee of the hospital, you are a WHEA member. So welcome. What you may not know, that you can be a dues-paying member. So we try to encourage the employees to donate $1 each paycheck to WHEA. It's deposited into our account, and that allows us to support programs and services and also give back to the employees. So we have two ways that we raise money. The first would be the dues-paying members. That's very significant to what we do. We have 1,894 employees as of 2 days ago, and we have 927 of those that are dues-paying members. So that is significant and helps keep us running. The second way we raise money, and one of our only big fundraiser, is the Festival of the Arts parking. The hospital allows us to use the Washington West parking lot during the Fremont Festival of the Arts, and we charge $5 per car, and we hand out a parking pass that shows on it what programs are being supported with that $5. So we just, as you know, we had just had the festival, and we made approximately $6,300. So that'll help carry us through. So I'm going to start off by telling you about what WHEA does for the hospital employees. Once a year, we plan a family fun day, or family fun days, because it's held on a Saturday of one weekend and a Sunday of another, so that all employees can participate. And this past year, we did the Niles Christmas Train. We will also try to do that again this year. We were able to, with the help of the with the medical staff and our own funds, we were able to significantly subsidize this event. We purchased 100 tickets, and we sold out in a matter of minutes. It was like trying to get a campsite at Yosemite, and we had the same reaction from the employees when they didn't get it. So this year, we're going to go for 200 tickets if possible. Okay. So some of the events that we do every year are sporting events. We buy tickets to the A's, the Giants, Warriors, if we can get them, and the San Jose Sharks. And we subsidize those tickets to dues-paying members. So if you're a non-dues-paying member, we still have a very nice discount from these organizations. If you're a dues-paying member, you have an additional discount. We subsidize your ticket. Great America goes for about 3 months, also subsidized. This is a nice one if you like the theater. You don't have to do anything but enter the code for Washington Hospital, and you receive a significant discount to theater tickets all year round and for any seats in the theater. Alameda County Fair tickets, and which a lot of you may already know, our annual pumpkin carving contest. We have up here two of the winners from last year, Miss Colorado. I think she was a pun from the Miss Universe contest. And then we have, I believe that's the Day of the Dead display. Those are two of our winners. At the, it's kind of builds a little camaraderie between departments. The winners get a gift certificate for lunch. And the whole hospital comes down and votes on the pumpkins and grabs a piece of pumpkin pie. So it's a lot of fun. Another thing we do for hospitals and patients together is our WIA wish list. This picture only represents one item that we have done this year. These are the Staxi wheelchairs. They're quite pricey, and they were on the three departments' wish lists. I'll go over. The wish list is put out once a year. The criteria is it has to be for patient care. Okay, so we do. We've done crayons for children, TVs for waiting rooms while patients are waiting, and maybe a long time, then they have something to watch. The Staxi chairs are very important to Washington West, especially getting the patients from the cars, for the family members to get their patients from the cars to the services needed. The one in the middle is for the infusion center. It has a IV pole and it has an oxygen tank holder. You see there with Kimberly McFarland, I think that was her first day of work with our volunteer George, sporting their new wheelchair with their patient. I think that's Winky Doo sitting there. And then we have urgent care. Urgent care always has their patients needing help back and forth. I also like to play a little hide and seek with Patty with those. She leaves them out in the parking lot. I hide them in the library. She always knows where to find them. So now we'll go on to community support. What is WIA doing for the community? Here we have a picture of last year's backpack drive. We do a backpack challenge. We give a bag out to each department and we ask them to fill it with school supplies. For each backpack that's filled, they get a ticket for a pizza lunch, whoever wins. Last year we did over 40 backpacks, and I think we'll be doing that again this year. So those go to Abode and Save. Speaking of Abode, this year on the bottom picture, that's Carol Arada picking up items from the sock and undie drive that we had. And while she was here, I said, Carol, if there's anything Abode ever needs, let me know. So within an hour, I had an email and said, hey, you know, our pantries are really empty. Can you guys run a food drive? Well, we were also selling A's tickets, and the backpack drive was coming up. So it's kind of a lot to ask for people to do. Well, our hospital community in 1 week came through with 4 barrels of food to refill the pantries for Abode. So I was really pleased with that. Save, I'm sure most of you are familiar, Safe Alternatives to Violent Environments. This young lady, this was her first day at Save, working at Save. She came over to pick up the socks and undies. We also support the events that they have. They're having their 40th anniversary gala. We will be supporting. We support the Eye Opener Breakfast, and as well as we do a gift card drive during the holidays for Save. And also Abode. Blood drive. You might recognize our past president, Mike Rogers, and donating blood. This was last year. We do this twice a year. And this last one we just did, we had 35 people registered, which is the maximum that can register. And they gave 32 pints of blood. So that was a record high for the hospital. And we are having another one again in September. So let's get ready for that. A new thing that we started 2 years ago at the request, who I think he's here, Doug Van Houten, I saw him somewhere, clothing for patients. As you must see or be aware that oftentimes patients will come in a condition of which they cannot leave in the same clothes. Sadly enough, some may not have family members or somebody to support them to bring them clothes. So what are you going to do? They need clothes to leave. So we has budgeted $650 a year to supply shoes, socks, underwear, t-shirts, and sweatshirts so that they could at least leave with a new outfit and hopefully a healthy new lifestyle. So with that, does anybody have any questions about WIA, what we contribute? Nope, you're good? Okay. Now, for the main reason we're here tonight, is for the Don Pickenpah Memorial Scholarship. First of all, I'd like to thank our chairperson this year, Tiffany Ross, for taking this on. It's a very long process of applications, screening the applications, and getting all the packets out to the judges and getting us here tonight. So thank you, Tiffany, for doing that. We have four judges, Dr. John Romano and Dr. Russell Nord, who couldn't be here tonight, but they have been a very big part of this process for at least the last 7 years since I've been involved in it. John Lee is new this year as one of our judges, and thank you, John, for stepping up to this, and it was fun working with you. And Katie Troy, I think here she is. I think that's her second year doing this. So I just want to thank you guys for taking the time to go through all the applications and do this. Let me go on to the scholarship criteria that's listed here. It's basic criteria. The one thing that I'm really excited about our scholarship compared to other scholarships in the hospital is it does not have to be medical based. So it doesn't matter if your student is going to go into the medical field, it could be anything. They just have to be attended accredited community college on at least a half-time basis. Another thing I like about our criteria is it's very well weighed out. So it's not always just the highest GPA. The GPA is definitely taken into consideration, but also community service, their own personal statement and how they feel about their future and what they're contributing. And also we ask them to identify with Don Pickenpah and who he was to the community. So it's a lot of work for them. It's not just filling out an application. So I'd like to tell you a little bit about Don Pickenpah in case you don't know. So Don Pickenpah was the longest serving member of the Washington Hospital District Board of Directors. He was first elected in 1976, and he was elected board president 5 times during his 27-year tender. Mr. Pickenpah's most notable contribution to the hospital were the acquisition of Washington West in 1997, which was also the end of Emporium Capwell's, and the renovation of the hospital's 6th floor in 2002. Mr. Pickenpah's interest in healthcare developed when he served as a Navy Chief Hospital Corpsman. He supervised the operations of the emergency rooms at a major naval hospital and served as the Chief Laboratory and Blood Bank Technician. He was deeply involved in the community. He was actively involved in the Boy Scouts, Alameda County's Highland Hospital Citizens Committee, and the Alameda County Tax Assessment Appeals Board. He was also a reading mentor at a Fremont elementary school. So that's who Don Pickenpah was, and as you see, very much into community and helping in the community. So with that, this is how we came with our recipient tonight. A recipient of the Don Pickenpah Memorial Scholarship is Hannah Luterio. Let me tell you a little bit about Hannah. Hannah graduated this year from Moreau High School in Hayward. She'll be attending San Jose State University in the fall to pursue a major in marketing. Hannah would like to incorporate her passion for photography, video, and graphic design with her marketing major. When evaluating the scholarship candidates, one important factor is someone who embodies the traits of Don Pickenpah, who had a strong commitment to helping others in the community. Hannah has over 200 hours of community service during her high school career. She was involved with campus ministry as well as Link Crew in her school. in Hannah's letters of recommendation from her advisors at Moreau, we found over and over was a mention of her commitment to helping others. She was asked to take the lead to produce a marketing video for Moreau's neighbor school, St. Clement. According to her multimedia instructor, she took on the challenge with enthusiasm and professionalism. This is what kind of impressed us quite a bit. Her teacher said, "It is rare that a teacher can completely rely on an 18-year-old in this type of scenario." Evidently, she took the job with joy, ran with it, and produced the video. Another instructor wrote, "Of my 18 years of education, Hannah ranks among the top three students I have ever had the pleasure of teaching." As I went on to read more of his letter, he was a new teacher at Moreau High School, and Hannah made sure that he got to meet the other students, that he had everything that he needed, and she even helped him with some of his presentations. So Hannah, you know, of all of our applicants, Hannah really just stood out and embodied what we were looking for in the Don Pickenpah Memorial Scholarship. So with that, I'd like to have Hannah come up so you can meet her. Hannah, I think you're behind the wall. Come on up. Hannah's not as outspoken as you would think when we've met her. but we're really proud of you, and you should be proud of yourself, and I'm sure your parents are just beaming with pride. Hannah's mom works in the ICU. In the ICU and here at the hospital. And here we go. I'd like to present you with the certificate of recognition, and we will be sending the $2,000 straight over to San Jose State, so we make sure it goes right here. And we'd like to take some pictures with you if you don't mind.
Yeah,
okay,
sure.
Thank you. And thank you guys for taking the time to hear about WIA. Thank you.
Let's take a look.
Parents are requested.
Yeah.
Come on.
I thought it was mandatory.
Absolutely.
All right. Right here. Hannah will have you stand in the front.
There you go. Yeah, catch him over
there. We got a lot of people there.
All right.
And Nancy.
And if we got Nancy, come on.
Yeah.
There we go.
All right.
All right.
Boy, it's so beautiful to see such hardworking students. And thank you, Christy, for all the hard work and you and the rest of WIA has done to help the community and really to forward the whole Washington Hospital family. What we see tonight is just one small bit of what you guys actually do. So we appreciate
you for having us tonight.
It's our joy. Thank you. It won't be as fun without you. All right. I'd entertain a motion for the consideration of the minutes of July 13, 18, 25, and 27.
So moved.
We have a motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Christine, if you could call the roll.
Director Nicholson?
Aye.
Director Stewart?
Aye.
Director Danielson?
Aye.
Director Ethan?
Aye.
Thank you. Motion passes. I think we're going to take things a little bit out of order since we're waiting for somebody to arrive, and we're going to go to the credentialing action items, which are going to be presented by Dr. Choi. Dr. Choi is substituting for Dr. Achanta, who is
vacationing somewhere.
All right. That's good for him.
Before I give this month's credentialing report, I want to inform the board that Dr. Achanta misspoke in his credentials report of July 13th, and there are actually, as a correction, the medical staff report for doctors asked for, and Dr. Ho was indeed correct as originally written, and both physicians are requesting deletion of their internal medicine privileges, and Dr. Ho is actually moving to ambulatory. Okay. With that, we'll continue on. For new applicants and appointments, we have Dr. Abrin Belay of Internal Medicine, Dr. Wendy Su of Critical Care, Dr. Nasat Soleimani, OB Hospitalist, and Dr. Yi Chun Wang, Internal Medicine Hospitalist. Temporary privileges for Dr. Abrin Belay, PA Christy LaRock, Dr. Vandana Sharma in Hospice of Palliative Care, Dr. Nasat Soleimani, OB Hospitalist, Dr. Yi Chun Wang, Internal Medicine, and Vanessa Wilson, Hyperbaric Medicine. Under locum tenens, we have PA Edward Rosenbach. We also have Dr. Ranu Gualbal for Radiation Oncology. For reappointments, we have many. The first is Dr. Sarkis Bani Paulson of Family Medicine. For ambulatory, Dr. Kevin Bauer of Cardiology, Dr. Elwin Khabibi, Hematology Oncology, Courtesy Staff, Dr. Varun Chawla, Nephrology, Dr. Ki Che, Nephrology, Dr. Walter Chang, Internal Medicine, Dr. Alexandra Cole, Pediatric Hospitalist, Stephen Curran, Family Medicine, Dr. Amir Daska, Podiatry, Dr. Mei Ji, OBGYN, Dr. John Giddens, Ambulatory, Dr. Kadir Halimi, Emergency Medicine, Dr. Michael Harmon, Radiation Oncology, Courtesy Staff, Dr. Lubna Hussain, Emergency Medicine, Dr. Shakir Haider, GI, Gastroenterology, Dr. Sunitha Kaiser, Pediatrics, Dr. Amy Kane, OBGYN, Dr. Rishi Kapila, Internal Medicine, Dr. Simon Kim, Urology, Dr. Suvarchala Kampela, Internal Medicine, Dr. Koi Lam, Emergency Medicine, Dr. Kirk Lin, Gastroenterology, Dr. David Miller, Infectious Disease Courtesy, Dr. Ricardo Molina, Orthopedics Active, Dr. Kavitha Raj, Hematology Oncology, Dr. Tushar Rancho, Ophthalmology, Dr. Andrew Saunders, Pediatric Hospitalist, and Dr. Anamika Sharma, Pediatric Ambulatory. We also have, under the same category, Dr. Allison Slack, OBGYN, Dr. Stacy Solt, Emergency Medicine, Dr. Alan Spira, Emergency Medicine, Dr. Arun Savatsa, Gastroenterology, Dr. Sahil Sood, Pediatrics, Dr. Shalini Sundar, Nephrology, Dr. Daniel Sweeney, Critical Care, and Dr. Francis Wong, Anesthesiology. Under conditional reappointments, we have Dr. G.S. Reen, and under completion of proctoring and advancement in staff category, we have Benjamin G. for Radiology and Dr. Kennedy Wong for Internal Medicine. Under completion of proctoring and eligibility for advancement in staff category, we have Kelly Franco, Nurse Practitioner. We have Vincent Ray, Ophthalmology, and Joseph Kwok, Anesthesia. Under new privilege requests, we have Dr. Vandana Sharma, Medicine, Hematology, Oncology for Hospice and Palliative Care. Under Vanessa Wilson, we have Internal Medicine with Hyperbaric Medicine Privileges. Deleting privilege requests, we have Dr. Elwin Khabibi, Hematology Oncology, deleting internal medicine procedures and cross-departmental CCU level 3. Walter Chang, Internal Medicine, deleting internal medicine procedures. Dr. Stephen Curran, Family Practice, deleting cross-department CCU level 1 privileges. Dr. Rishi Kapila, Internal Medicine Hospitalist, deleting internal medicine procedures. Dr. Suvarchala Kampela, Internal Medicine Hospitalist, deleting internal medicine procedures. Dr. David Miller, Infectious Disease, deleting internal medicine procedures. Dr. Andrew Saunders, Pediatric Hospitalist, deleting assistant surgery and cross-departmental CCU levels 1, 2, and 3. Dr. Sahil Sood, Pediatric Hospitalist, deleting assistant surgery and cross-departmental CCU level 1. Shalini Sundar, Nephrology, deleting internal medicine procedures. And resignations include Saman Lee, PA, and Dr. Choi Nguyen, internal medicine.
Thank you very much, Dr. Choi. Any questions for Dr. Choi? If not, then I'll entertain a motion for approval of the credentialing action items as presented by Dr. Choi.
So moved, Mr. President.
And we have a second.
Second.
Thank you. We have a motion and a second. Christine, with a roll call.
Director Nicholson?
Aye.
Director Stewart?
Aye.
Director Danielson?
Aye.
Director Eben?
Aye.
Great. Thank you very much. We've got approval of that credentialing action items. Let's continue to take the agenda out of order, and we're going to go on to our Service League report. Debbie.
Hi. Good evening, everyone. During the month of July, the Service League was quite busy again, as usual. I'm sure most of you, did you all get your newsletter? We distribute our newsletter again. And the board today voted to have a permanent assignment for the infusion center for staffing for volunteers. The goal, my personal feeling is that I want to try and get volunteers that are appropriate for this assignment, and ones that will always be there. So the consistent, because it really helps with the patients to have the same volunteers that are there. And if you're working on a Wednesday, you work all Wednesdays or Fridays, that type of thing. So that way it keeps the continuity and it makes it nicer for the patients. It's been a very rewarding staffing. I've enjoyed it tremendously. So I'm happy to report that the board is approved that to this evening. That's the Service League board, I should say. The gift shop is in progressing, and I just got back from the Las Vegas gift, the wholesale mart, you know, for merchandise, and it was quite overwhelming. It was amazing, but I learned a lot. I want to thank Lily Stamets from UCSF, who is the gift shop manager. She took me under her wing, and she was wonderful, and she's been a great mentor to help me as I gain more knowledge in this area. We are in the process of adding the triage to our emergency department. And Gail Tomika has been wonderful about working with the existing volunteers to get them up and running to know what is expected of being in the triage area. And we have one more training tomorrow on that. During the month of July, our volunteer adults gave 1,454 hours of volunteer time. College was 591. Students was 770. Spiritual care was 276. And trainees was 353. Trainees was quite high. We've done an amazing job with Kimberly as our new assistant director bringing in new volunteers. And it's so needed, for especially our gift shop and our lobby. And so giving us a total of volunteer hours of 3,444 hours last month. So that pretty much covers it.
Thank you, Debbie. You know, it's wonderful to hear that our UCSF affiliation has extended to collaboration with the gift shop. I'm glad to hear that she took you under the wing and can learn from each other. That's part of the whole UCSF affiliation.
Yes, but she's been wonderful.
That's great. I think that's wonderful, and it's good to see such great work you guys are doing.
Thank you.
So when are the sales going to be?
I was down in the cage this morning, mm-hmm, checking things out to see. So we'll see.
Okay. So yeah, you'll let us
but,
know.
I'm hoping
September
to have lots of new items for the holidays coming up. And I really, really want to focus on making sure that the gift shop is meeting the needs of many of the patrons that are here, the community, the diversity, and so suggestions are welcomed.
Great. Well, thank you so much, Debbie.
You're welcome.
Great. We'll continue out of order with. Is she here?
She's arrived.
All right. Okay. We're in business. So now we'll go back to regular order and move on to our communications. And I believe, are there any other oral communications other than Dr. Jane?
We'll start with Dr. Jane.
Yeah.
Please.
Great. Ash.
Thank you.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, Ms. Farber. I am going to be presenting on behalf of our Great Start program, and we are going to be awarded a award by the American Heart. And before that, I'd just like to give a brief summary on our program. The program is a team of physicians and nurses that you see, but behind this are at least a dozen teams that support this program. And any one of this piece missing could really destroy the program. It starts with patients, education, the 911, EMS, the emergency department, which plays a huge role of triaging, and the ER docs helping us out, and the ER nurses. And then we have the best set of stroke nurses, which was developed over the last 9 years by Doug himself, who's here today, though he is quote-unquote retired. I don't know how much I trust that or believe that. But under his guidance, we built a great stroke program with the stroke nurses that he's left behind, a set of stroke nurses that can really take over what he used to do as a single-handed person. Then we have the radiology supporting us, the lab, the interventionalists, and we have a great set of neurologists that have been supporting this program. The four of them really are dedicated to the program. And then we have the stroke unit nurses that we have and the rehab services. Not to forget the administration that really started the program and continue to support it. So without any of these, I don't think so we could have set up this program. We have been growing. We grew quite a bit in the beginning, and then we dropped off and have stabilized around 500 patients a year because of the other stroke programs that have mushroomed in the area. And despite that, we do not see any fall, because I think we've set a program and the community education that patient awareness and the 911 and the EMS services that bring the patients to us because of our services. One of the awards that we are going to get today is because of the core measures that we maintain. And this is Get With The Guideline and the JCO core measures. And we are above the 85% goal. We strive for 100%, believe it or not. Miss one or two here and there, but generally we are in the range of 95 to 100%. The stroke mortality, which I really am proud of, is we are much below the state average and the national averages. You see, we are in the green line, and the national and the state averages are red. So we do pretty well, and this goes for the ischemic and hemorrhagic strokes. This is another measure that we that is why we are getting an award, which is giving TPA, which is to recanalize the arteries that are blocked and that cause strokes. The measure is 50% of the patients should receive TPA within 60 minutes in ischemic strokes. And you see that we are prepared for the next set of challenges that they are going to bring. We are much above 50%. Our standard is 80%, and really we would like to go for 100% on that if we can. So we are prepared for the next sets of standards that AHA or Get With The Guidelines are going to bring. This is, again, 50% of patients receive TPA within 45 minutes of their arrival. So 60 minutes is one of the criteria. We are now looking at 45 minutes, and that is what the standards are going to be. And we are above 53%. This is for 2017 goal. So we have already achieved that goal. And you know what? I get these emails on a daily basis that we are trying to beat our own record. Yesterday was 29 minutes. The time before was 28 minutes. So these people are just tracking those minutes. And that just tells you how involved they are in treating these patients. Basically, they want to break this, they want to give TPA as soon as possible, which is what's going to help these patients. So I'm sure we are going to get better results with mortality, morbidity, and bringing these folks back to work. The achievements that we've had in the last 8 years are, we've had year-on-year Gold Plus Award. There is a Platinum Award to this, and one of these days we will go for that, but that includes congestive heart failure. That has nothing to do with stroke. We'll need to work on that to get that Platinum Award. But as far as the stroke goes, Gold Plus is the maximum that one can get, and we've been getting that year on year. Health Grades 5-star award for stroke, we got that. We are in the top 5% stroke programs in the country. We have education programs that I'll show you a few slides on, and the stroke research program that I want to mention a little bit about. Comprehensive stroke program. We are not a comprehensive certified JCO program, but we are a comprehensive program, and we've been that for the last 5 years. We cannot get the certification because of some other criteria, but we behave and we work as a comprehensive program. Then we introduced our interventional radiology program in 2010, and that is why we are really comprehensive, which is going on pretty well. And we just received Joint Commission's recertification last year in October, November. The education programs we have in the community education, which I was just talking to Doug about because he used to do quite a bit of this, and now he is going to have the nurses, stroke nurses, start doing this for us. And then we have patient education, which is done at every level, at the level of the admission, on the floors, at the time of discharge, and then they are brought back in form of community education lectures that we give on a monthly basis, and also the support group that we have. And then there is conferences that we do on a monthly basis. It is for the interventionalist, as well as it is for any case that we do, which we give TPA, and is interesting, we present on a monthly basis. We do about 4 cases a month, and we give TPA to about 4 to 8 patients a month. So we cover all of those so that we learn from each other. And the neurologists, the ER docs, the nurses, they attend this program. The other important thing that has been happening over the last 2 years is the atrial fibrillation and the paroxysmal atrial fibrillation. The incidence of stroke is thought that 30 to 40% of the strokes are caused because of atrial fibrillation. Atrial fibrillation is an irregular heartbeat. And there is two parts of that. One is a patient is in irregular heartbeat all the time, and that is called atrial fibrillation. And then sometimes it is this irregular rhythm comes and goes, and that has caused paroxysmal atrial fibrillation. Both of these are dangerous and cause strokes because of blood clots. And so we've been looking at this, and we've been, if you see that, we make sure that any patient that has a diagnosis of atrial fibrillation or paroxysmal atrial fibrillation, they are on blood thinners, because that is what prevents strokes. And if you see, we are above 94-95%, and the target definitely is 100%. Also, the second important thing is, how fast can we recanalize? I just told you that our TPA time is 45 minutes, which is giving the blood thinning medicine in the emergency room. The second aspect of this is, if we find a blood clot in the brain, and if we think that the TPA is not going to be working, we need to take this patient to the emergency, to the cath lab, the imaging center, and go into the artery and pull the clot out or dissolve the clot. So that is the second aspect. And this needs to be done very fast, too. And we know that if it is done in a timely manner, our success rates will be higher, the patient outcomes will be better. And that is what I am showing you in this graph here and this graph here, that the mortality is less, the morbidity is less, if we are efficient and do it in an expedited manner. And this is something that we need to work on more, because there is room to improve. We do research, we do quite a bit of research presentations. The two areas that we are focusing are on our atrial fib and the paroxysmal atrial fib, and the patients with renal failure. What is seen is that patients with renal failure, their blood is thin because of various issues that they have with the blood cells called platelets, and do they need as much anticoagulation as a normal person would in atrial fibrillation? So we are looking at those, that group of patients, and there's very little data on that. So I think it'll be, since we have a database of 5,500 patients, to mine that data for this aspect will, I think, help further education in this area. The award that we are going for, that we are receiving today, is a stroke honor roll elite plus award. So we bypassed the stroke honor roll, stroke honor roll elite, and now we've gone to the plus, which is basically time to thrombolytic therapy within 60 minutes in 75% or more acute ischemic stroke patients treated with TPA, and dose to needle time within 45 minutes in 50% of the acute ischemic strokes. So you have to meet both these elements to receive that award. And if they had a elite plus plus, I think we will get that too, because we are prepared for that. The future projects that I would recommend that we should look into are, we are taking good care of these patients in the hospital. I think we've achieved a lot in giving care to the hospital, but once they leave the hospital, what happens to this, these patients? How are they taken care of? What the outcome is? I think that data is missing from everywhere. Really, there's no good data on that yet. And I think that is the aspect that we need to work on, whether they go to SNFs, acute rehabs, homes, how they fare after that, whether they go back to work, how functional they are. We are missing that. And also 20 to 25% of patients have recurrent strokes. We need to avoid that. We need to really stop that from happening, because it's easy to do that. So those are that is the aspect that I think we should focus on. And the second thing, like I just mentioned, the second aspect of recanalization of arteries in the cath lab, our time, during the daytime it is good, but evening and nighttime, we are not as good. And I think we need to focus on that and set up some criteria so that we can cut down on that time also. And that would help with the outcomes. So those are the two projects that we are going to try to focus on and work with everybody to see if we can make that happen. Thank you, and let's go on with the awards.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you, and I apologize for being late. I was stuck in traffic and outside of San Francisco. So my name is Elena Gunn. I'm the Regional Director for Quality and Systems Improvement with the American Heart and American Stroke Association. And I'm here to present this award. And I want to acknowledge that, well, first off, Dr. Jane did a great job at explaining exactly what the award criteria was, which is makes my job easier. But I want to explain what the significance of this is. So stroke is the number three cause of death in the United States. It's also the number one cause of long-term disability in the United States, and that's an enormous amount of cost to the healthcare system and also in terms of quality of life. And so when we reach these numbers that Dr. Jane was talking about, these numbers of, you know, how quickly we get TPA, door to needle time, things like that, that is the difference between someone walking out in a wheelchair or somebody leaving the hospital in a wheelchair or walking out. It's the difference between somebody being able to go back to work or someone being home for the rest of their life disabled severely. And so the more that we are able to focus on how quickly and efficiently and accurately we can diagnose and treat stroke patients, the better the outcome for the patients, the better the quality of life, the better the long-term issues, and ultimately reduces the cost of healthcare on our system. And we're seeing a lot of cost come to our health care system as the entire baby boomer generation starts to retire. So it is a significant feat, and Washington Hospital certainly does goes way above what the national recognitions are. So I want to acknowledge Dr. Jane and also also Doug. Did I see him? Where is he? He's behind them. Yes. And the entire stroke team. And in addition to the stroke team, this does require a system-wide approach. So my department is quality and systems improvement. This requires emergency departments, pre-hospital, the EMS agencies, and communication with the emergency care, the paramedics and the emergency care agencies before patients ever even arrive here. It requires the emergency department, the head of the ED, and the entire ED department to know how to proceed when a stroke alert comes in. It requires radiology to be ready and someone to be ready to read these scans within 7 to 9 minutes of when they're done. It requires pharmacy to be able to have this medication here, which has to be mixed immediately before it's given to the patient. And then all of the extended care that goes along with it. So I may have left some folks out, but so this is a system approach. And so for the fact that you not only receive this, but have received this award for several years in a row, it means that the system is working very well. So the other thing that I would mention is it's very nice to win awards, but it's even better to really live and serve your community. And I think that's what Dr. Jane and what Doug and the entire group of caregivers involved in this, I think ultimately that's what they're doing. And you can walk out of here and know that if someone you know and love comes in with a stroke, that they're going to get the best care possible. And that's really the most important thing, right? So the plaque is nice, but I will give the plaque nonetheless.
No, that's not that.
Yes.
Doug?
Everybody come from behind the post, Doug.
John, all of you come.
So this, in addition to this award, you should have, if you have not already received, U.S. News and World Report, this August edition. American Heart has taken out a giant ad, and you will be named and honored in U.S. News and World Report. In addition, you will be acknowledged at the International Stroke Symposium. International Stroke Conference, which is in Houston, and the scientific sessions in New Orleans this year. So it is my honor to award Washington Hospital Healthcare System with the Get With The Guidelines Stroke 2016 Gold Plus Target Stroke Honor Roll Elite Plus Award. Congratulations for your hard work.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Who wants to take it?
Yes, I will take it. Come over there.
We are very much aware of what the comprehensive stroke requirements are for that designation from Joint Commission. And what stands between us and reaching that are two things. One are intensive care beds dedicated to this purpose, which will be resolved with the new hospital building, which is just 2 years away. And the other piece is the MRI being in-house. That also is something we're seeking a solution for. So in 2018, it would be this district's intention to seek the Comprehensive Stroke Center designation and build on the success that we've had serving our community and saving so many lives.
Thank you. Thank you, Elena, for battling the Bay Area traffic to come over here and acknowledge the terrific stroke program that we have. And on behalf of the board, but more importantly, on behalf of the whole community, I want to really congratulate the whole stroke team led by Dr. Jane, able assistance by Doug, and our great stroke nurses and wonderful neurologists, the whole team. And it really is a team approach which accomplishes these results. And, you know, Elena really made the point. Dr. Jane presented a lot of powerful statistics, but really what's important is the results. And it's a wonderful thing when the hard work that you all do results in somebody walking out of the hospital fully functional, able to go back to their home, not having to go to a nursing home. I don't know that the community really understands the terrific work that you all do. And it's been a long time that you've been working on this, and clearly we see that things are getting better every year. And I think that really just demonstrates the dedication that you have to this service and a service to the community. So again, on behalf of the board, thank you so much. I appreciate all the hard work. All right, we'll move on to our medical staff report. Dr. Choi.
So I'd like to report that the medical staff membership is up to 576 members with 356 active members, which is a slight increase from last time.
That's it?
That's it.
Okay, good. Okay, Nancy, hospital calendar.
Past health promotions and outreach events. The Central Park Summer Concert Series continued on July 14th, 21st, 28th, and August 4th. As the presenting co-sponsor for the six-week series, representatives from Washington Hospital, including nursing, maternal child health education, green team, sports medicine, cardiac rehab, wellness center, stroke team, and the Washington Township Medical Foundation provided health information and health screenings. The remaining concert will be held on Thursday, August 11th, and will include representatives from the Infusion Center and Urgent Care, along with information on advanced healthcare directives. On Saturday, July 16th, Washington Hospital and the Taylor McAdam Bell Neurosciences Institute hosted the 8th Bay Area Symposium on Advances in Neurosciences. World-class neurologists, neurosurgeons, radiation oncologists, and other healthcare professionals spoke at the symposium. Nationally and internationally recognized experts discussed a wide range of topics focused on neurological diseases, disorders, and treatment approaches. The program coordinators were Dr. Sandeep Kunwar, neurosurgeon, Dr. David Larson, radiation oncologist, and Dr. Moses Tagioff, neurosurgeon. 78 people attended. On Tuesday, July 19th, as part of the Palliative Care Community Presentations, Dr. Vandana Sharma, oncologist, moderated the Palliative Care Demystified panel discussion. The Palliative Care Community Presentation Program is a three-part series designed to educate and demystify palliative care. Palliative care is about treating the physical, emotional, social, and spiritual needs of the patient and their family. 27 people attended. On Thursday, July 21st, Dr. Sunil Dhawan, dermatologist, presented The Sun, the Beauty or the Beast. 10 people attended. Also on Thursday, July 21st, as part of the Women Empowering Women series, Dr. Victoria Liepart, gynecologist, presented Strong Women, Strong Bones. The presentation included bone density screenings for osteoporosis. 19 women attended. On Wednesday, August 3rd, as part of the Washington Sports Medicine and Washington Outpatient Rehab Center bi-monthly education series, Dr. Stephen Zahner, Family Practice and Sports Medicine Specialist, presented Big Changes in Concussion Care, What You Don't Know Can Hurt You.
17 people attended. On Thursday, August 4th, as part of the Diabetes Matters series, Vida Reed, RN, presented Monitoring Matters. 17 people attended. Upcoming health promotions and community outreach events. On Tuesday, August 16th, from 6:30 to 8 p.m., as part of the Palliative Care Community Presentations, Father Jeff Finley will moderate the Palliative Care, How Can This Help Me? Panel discussion. On Thursday, August 18th, from 7 to 8:30 p.m., as part of the Women Empowering Women series, Dr. Victoria Leapart, gynecologist, will present How to Sleep Your Way to Better Health. On Tuesday, September 6th, from 6 to 8 p.m., as part of the Stroke Education Series, Dr. Ash Jane, cardiologist, and Melissa Reyes, RN, will present Stroke Prevention and Other Disease Processes and Healthy Lifestyle, Be Smart and Avoid Stroke. On Thursday, September 8th, from 6 to 8 p.m., Dr. Victoria Leapart, gynecologist, will present Mindful Healing. On Tuesday, September 13th, from 12 to 1 p.m., as part of the Washington Women's Center Lunch and Learn series, Dr. Vandana Sharma, oncologist, will present Early Detection and Prevention of Female Cancers. On Wednesday, September 14th, as part of the Speakers Bureau, Christy Caracappa, Health Insurance Information Service Coordinator, will provide an overview of the Health Insurance Information Service Program to the Optimist Club of Newark. The Washington Hospital Healthcare Foundation Report. On Saturday, October 8th, the Washington Hospital Healthcare Foundation will host the 30th Annual Top Hat Dinner Dance. This year's gala will be chaired by Marlene Wybell, Dr. Albert Brooks, and Dr. Elizabeth Kirkjohn. The trustees of the foundation have designated the proceeds from this year's Top Hat Gala towards a new prenatal diagnostic center, which will provide much-needed services to expecting mothers, especially those who are at high risk. The foundation accepted sponsorships for the gala. Thanks are due to the following returning sponsors: Dearborn Saw Institute for Joint Restoration, Fremont Bank, Professional Home Care Associates, Neurosport Rehabilitation Associates, Gonzalez and Kozinchenko, Palo Alto Medical Foundation, Pacific Gas and Electric, Rona Consulting, Valic, and Bank of America Merrill Lynch. To reserve seats at Top Hat or inquire about sponsorship opportunities, please call the foundation at 510-791-3428. The Washington Township Healthcare District Board of Directors Report. The Washington Township Healthcare District Board members attended the Union City Chamber of Commerce Spirit Awards Luncheon on Wednesday, July 13th. Washington Hospital Employee Association, WEA. From July 11th through the 18th, WEA hosted a food drive to benefit those served at Abode Services. WEA collected 4 barrels of non-perishable items that were needed to restock pantries in various locations. The WEA Backpack Challenge for the back-to-school drive is underway. Each department is asked to donate items to fill a backpack for a student in need. The students range from kindergarten to college. Items collected will be donated by WEA to Abode and Save. The drive will end on August 12th. Washington on Wheels, WOW Mobile Health Clinic. During the month of July, the Washington on Wheels Mobile Health Clinic, WOW, continued to serve community members at the Fremont Family Resource Center, the Fremont Senior Center, and the Ruggieri Senior Center in Union City. Washington on Wheels continued with the summer's free glucose screenings at the Fremont Main Library, as well as all regularly scheduled community sites. In July, WOW provided glucose screenings to 71 individuals, and of those, 11 people tested had higher than normal glucose levels. They are undergoing further testing and treatment for diabetes. Visit www.whhs.com/wow or call 510-608-3203 for more information on where screenings will take place. On Wednesday, July 27th, Washington on Wheels provided occupational health services to 20 employees at Exelitas Technologies. Exelitis Technologies provides innovative, customized optoelectronics and advanced electronic systems to a global customer base. The total number of community members receiving health care from the Washington on Wheels Clinic during the month of July was 111. Internet and social media marketing. Washington Hospital's website serves as a central source of information for the communities the district serves and beyond. The most viewed web pages include Employment, Physician Finder, About WHHS, Volunteers, and Women's Health and Pregnancy. The hospital's social media presence is measured through total reach and engagement stats. The total reach statistic represents the total number of people who saw a Washington Hospital Facebook post. Social media posts may reach a user via a news feed, which is most common, a user's page timeline, or via a direct link to a hospital post. The engagement statistic represents users who liked, commented, shared, or clicked on a Washington Hospital Facebook post. InHealth, Channel 78. During the month of July, Washington Hospital's cable channel 78, InHealth, captured new programming, including a health and wellness program titled Learn the Latest Treatment Options for GERD, and a palliative care community presentation called Palliative Care Demystified. In addition, InHealth aired 5 health and wellness programs titled Not a Superficial Problem, Varicose Veins and Chronic Venous Disease, Cognitive Assessment as You Age, Vertigo and Dizziness, What You Need to Know, Urinary Incontinence in Women, and Nerve Compression Disorders of the Arms. InHealth also aired 2 sports medicine programs called Exercise Injuries and Prevention and Treatment of Youth Sports Injuries, a Diabetes Matters program titled The History of Diabetes, and the July Board of Directors meeting. For more information on any of the programs mentioned, visit WHHS.com or call 1-800-963-7070, and please follow us on Facebook and Twitter.
Thank you. I want to make a few remarks before I get to our Employee of the Month about 2 public health issues that have occupied a rather central place in the news media in recent weeks, both Zika and West Nile virus. The Zika virus, which was first discovered in the Zika forest in Uganda in 1947, is a common virus in Africa and Asia, spread to the Western Hemisphere sometime in the year 2013. Its presence, however, was not confirmed until May of 2015 and has rapidly swept across South and Central America since then. According to the latest statistics from the CDC, within the U.S., there have been 1,825 documented cases of Zika, with 1,818 of them as a result to travel to one of the areas that's been deemed active, 6 acquired from a mosquito bite. Within California, there have been 87 cases, no locally acquired infections, and that's important. However, it was recently reported that within the past 6 months, a baby with Zika-related birth defects was born in Alameda County. To help educate the residents of Washington Township, we've developed a short public service announcement to help empower the public with what they need to know to minimize the risk of contracting the disease. As with most threats to public health, knowledge is the best form of protection. We've included the resources that you can contact at the end of the public service announcement in the event that that's something you wish to do. So we'll start first with Zika.
As you may have seen on recent newscasts and articles in the media, the Zika virus is spreading throughout the world. In fact, the World Health Organization recently declared the Zika virus an international public health emergency.
As of now, the outbreaks in the Western Hemisphere have been confined primarily to Mexico, Central and South America. But cases have been reported in travelers returning from areas where the disease is prevalent.
Zika virus is transmitted to people primarily through the bite of an infected Aedes aegypti or Aedes albopictus mosquito. These mosquitoes are not native to California, but they have been detected in several California counties, including Alameda County. In May of 2015, two adult Aedes aegypti mosquitoes were found in the city of Hayward. No eggs, larvae, or adults have been found since then, and surveillance for these invasive Aedes mosquitoes is ongoing. Aedes aegypti and Aedes albopictus are small, black and white mosquitoes, and they tend to bite people in the daytime. They can breed in as little as a bottle cap of water, both indoors and outdoors near people. Invasive Aedes mosquitoes can only transmit Zika virus after they bite a person who has the virus in their blood. The infected mosquitoes can then spread the virus by biting other people. Since all mosquitoes require standing water to breed, we ask that you check your yard and dump and drain any containers holding water.
Some 80% of people infected with the Zika virus don't even feel sick. The most common symptoms are fever, rash, joint pain, or red eyes, known as conjunctivitis. The illness is usually mild, and symptoms can last from several days to a week. You should see your healthcare provider if you have visited an area of the world where Zika is found and you develop these symptoms. There are no vaccines or medications currently available to prevent or treat Zika infections. The best way to treat the symptoms is to get plenty of rest, drink fluids to prevent dehydration, take medicines such as acetaminophen to relieve fever and pain. Don't take aspirin or other non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs like ibuprofen and naproxen until dengue virus infection is ruled out. Zika virus infection during pregnancy is a cause of microcephaly and other severe fetal brain defects and has been linked to problems in infants, including eye defects, hearing loss, and impaired growth. Zika virus can be passed from males to their sexual partners. The virus is present in semen longer than in blood. Scientists are studying the full range of other potential health problems that Zika virus infection during pregnancy may cause. Pregnant women and their male partners who have visited areas where Zika virus is present should consult their healthcare providers to discuss if the woman should get a blood test for Zika virus infection.
Remember that the mosquitoes that spread the Zika virus bite mostly during the daytime. Here are some preventative measures to take. Wear long sleeve shirts and long pants. Stay in places with air conditioning or that provide window screens to keep mosquitoes out. Sleep under a mosquito bed net if you're otherwise unable to protect yourself from mosquito bites. Use only EPA registered insect repellents. Always follow product label instructions. Reapply insect repellent as directed. Do not spray on the skin under clothing. If using sunscreen, apply it before applying insect repellent. Treat clothing and gear with permethrin or purchase permethrin treated items.
Although the risk is low for anyone who has not traveled to the areas identified with active Zika virus transmission, it's best to stay vigilant and responsible, especially if you or your partner are pregnant or planning to get pregnant. Remember, the virus can spread if an infected Aedes mosquito were to bite you. As of now, these invasive Aedes mosquitoes have only been found in a dozen California counties. Therefore, for most of us, the chance of contracting Zika virus is remote.
For more information about Zika virus, visit Centers for Disease Control and Prevention website, the California Department of Public Health website, or the Alameda County Mosquito Abatement website.
Thank you. Now we're going to talk a little bit about West Nile virus. It's important to focus on this as well because it is well established in the state of California and has been detected in 34 counties throughout the state. While the number of human cases of West Nile virus is down so far in 2016 from 10 in 2015 to 3 this year. The number of dead birds has increased more than twofold, from 303, which were found in 2015, to 715 so far this year. Infected birds are one way to gauge West Nile virus activity. While there currently have been no reported human cases of West Nile virus in Alameda County, and 5 bird deaths reported, residents are advised to remain vigilant against mosquitoes. We've created a series of public service announcements about West Nile virus and what you can do to keep your family, your neighbors, and yourself safe and in the best possible position to prevent contracting West Nile virus. So we'll show those public service announcements now.
For many people in the Tri-Cities, West Nile virus seems like a remote danger. Many of the conditions mosquitoes and the West Nile virus need to thrive are converging in Alameda County. After being introduced into the Bay Area ecosystem years ago, West Nile virus is now reaching a potent part of its life cycle, and the mosquito population is about to bloom. So who's at risk? Well, we all are, but there are certain people who are much more susceptible than others. The main group of people to be concerned about are the elderly, your parents, grandparents, and even your older neighbors. Also, people with weakened immune systems. Someone who is already sick will have a tough time fighting up this viral infection too. For more information on who's at risk, how to protect your family, your home, and yourself, visit WHHS.com or mosquitoes.org. For many people in the Tri-Cities, West Nile virus seems like a remote danger. Many of the conditions mosquitoes and the West Nile virus need to thrive are converging in Alameda County. But don't worry, there's a lot you can do to prevent this disease. Screen your windows and doors. Keep outside lighting to a minimum near doors. But most importantly, eliminate any standing water. Even small pools can be a breeding ground for mosquitoes. Places you want to double check around your home include buckets, bird baths, old tires, plants, saucers, children's toys, and ponds. And if you have a fish pond, stock it with mosquito fish for free from mosquito abatement. For more information on who's at risk, how to protect your family, your home, and yourself, visit WHHS.com or mosquitoes.org. For many people in the Tri-Cities, West Nile virus seems like a remote danger. Many of the conditions mosquitoes and the West Nile virus need to thrive are converging in Alameda County. But don't worry, there's a lot you can do to prevent this disease. Use a mosquito repellent that contains DEET. While outdoors, wear pants and long sleeves. Stay inside at dawn and dusk. But most importantly, eliminate any standing water around your house and ask your neighbors to do the same. And don't forget to check the pool. A dirty one like this can be a breeding ground for mosquitoes, giving West Nile virus a golden opportunity. For more information on who's at risk, how to protect your family, your home, and yourself, visit WHHS.com or mosquitoes.org.
I also wanted to take a minute to talk a bit about what's going on in the affordable care world and the insurance world around us, because this is a problem a number of our patients are affected by. There has been a rather significant covered California rate increase this past week. Covered California announced a 13.2% rate increase for calendar year 2017, and this was driven by Covered California's largest two insurers, which account for about half of its enrollment. Blue Shield of California led the way with a 19% average increase statewide, and Anthem had an average increase of 17.2% in California. I think that is a very significant and complicating feature for this program. And with that, I'd like to go to a much happier place and announce Victor Salazar is our Employee of the Month for August. Oh, it's coming? Okay. All right. The Information Security Engineer, Victor Salazar, is our Employee of the Month. And we think he's very deserving of the award for his professionalism, his reliability, and integrity. He joined our Information Services Department in 2013. After his work on the EPIC system rollout as a contractor, Victor has been and continues to be an asset on many projects and work assignments, including, but not limited to, three new projects: our mobile device management project, the secure texting, and our Improvata single sign-on upgrade, while all at the same time still completing his day-to-day information security tasks. He's always been extremely helpful with completing any task and resolving issues, no matter how difficult. He makes sure his fellow colleagues and customers are satisfied with the results of a request and enable them to complete their work securely. He's married to a nurse and has two young children. In his free time, he enjoys taking his family to Giants and Warriors games. Well, I'm all for that, as well as going to the parks. I'd like to congratulate Victor.
Thank you, Nancy. I want to commend your team for developing those public service announcements regarding the Zika virus as well as the West Nile virus. Sounds like the take-home message for everybody in the community is drain and dump, and encourage your neighbors to do the same, because it's only by eliminating those sources of mosquito breeding that we'll be able to reduce the number of cases of these very serious illnesses. So drain and dump. Talk to your neighbors. So let's move on to Lean and Kaizen update. And Kimberly, it's yours.
So this evening, we're going to be giving some certifications out, but to begin with, just that wanting to talk a little bit about certifications. Do I need to bring it up? There we go. All right. As you are all aware, we have been working with Rona Consulting for almost 2 years on our Lean journey. And an important component of that is having individuals throughout our healthcare system, both employees and physicians, certified in Lean. And it's important so that they can continue our journey through all of this promotion and leading Kaizen activities. Lean certification, it's a 12 to 18 month process, and it requires proficiency at the Lean concepts, and we're evaluated at every step of the way in terms of our performance. There are specific requirements to being certified. The first is to attend 8 full days of classroom training. It is also to participate in a value stream mapping workshop, a Kaizen workshop, and then you need to do a team lead and a workshop lead. So it really shows that you're very competent and can teach to others the Lean concepts. At this point, we have 12 people that are certified, and so we have 5 tonight that we will be providing their certificates to. So I'd like to ask Dr. Nicholson and Nancy to come up, and I will call each person up, and we can present them with their a pin and their certification. Okay, so to begin with, we have Brenda Brennan from the emergency room. Next is Kristen Ferguson from Compliance. Next is Dr. Bettina Kirkjohn, and she is actually part of our Kaizen Promotion Office. Mm-hmm. Next is Donald Pipkin, Strategic Management. And then, one more. We have Deborah Brooks from nursing. Thank you.
Okay, Ed, Mr. Fahan, construction. Have we landed our helicopter?
Yeah, we did.
Thank you, Dr. Nicholson. So, first thing to talk about is the garage, and I have good news in this front, and that is that we opened on Monday, and we opened to about 80 cars, and then we've been up about twice that since then. So the employees are using it. We've had a lot of positive feedback. On Monday, we'll start with the contractors associated with the Hyman Pavilion using the top couple of floors. And on the 15th, we'll be open for business with the helicopters. We've had a couple of trial runs. I think there's going to be one more on Thursday, and then it'll be open for business for the helipad.
Tell me the name of the helicopter that we tried for the trial landing.
The name of the helicopter?
I believe it was Bear Force One.
It was from UCSF.
Air Force,
that's correct.
One helicopter.
That is correct. So obviously we are done. I think we have we were working on a few things with the bioswales that are out there that have to be finally signed off by the city to get our final certificate of occupancy, but we've been given the temporary permit some weeks ago. So this gives you a look at one of the bioswales. This is actually out in the parking area. There is a fairly large gradient in height of surfaces between the garage and the Hyman Pavilion. So you can see this is a fairly deep bioswale, and there's a couple of them out in the garage. This shows you one by the BART building that is completed in terms of all the work that the hospital had agreed to do. The tenant improvements are not finalized here, but you can see the exterior is completed, and there's a bioswale as part of that. The electric vehicle charging stations are in place and functioning. We have a couple of employees that are subject matter experts on these and use it on a regular basis. We've started to have physicians utilize it as well, I understand, right, Dr. Choi? This is one of the things we put on the first floor, which is called the Clearview Security Fence. And the first floor facing the BART area was pretty close to the sidewalk, so we thought this was sort of an extra level of security that we needed to put on that floor. As it faces the sidewalk around the garage back just off of Bartway. And you can see here all the construction fences are down. There is in place now the door to BART, so that is reopened and people have access right along the sidewalk into the back of the hospital via the employee entrance. And actually, it's very convenient in terms of just it's a short walk to get from the garage into the hospital for staff. So again, we're up, we're functioning, lots of positive feedback, one down.
Great. Okay. On budget?
Yes. Yes, we still have. We don't have the final invoices in yet, but yes, we're under budget now, and it appears we're going to finish well within our budget.
Great. Thank you very much.
The Hyman Pavilion, again, this is moving on right on time, right on budget as well. You can see a couple of things in these pictures. First, we are putting in the studs, and if you were to walk through the basement, the first floor in particular, that's really taking shape in terms of the rooms, the main lobbies. Those things are pretty well enclosed, and you can get a sense for how the place lays out. This is a shot on the second floor, so you can see other infrastructure being put in there. We're not quite as far on the studs, stud walls. And here shows some of the framing that's going on the terrace gardens on the second floor where the critical care pavilions are going to be. We're still doing some concrete work as of last week on the roof, and this is in preparation of equipment placement, which if you look out today, there's another large crane out there, and if you look on top of the building, you'll see some large air handling and filtration type equipment having been placed there just today. This is another thing. This is scaffolding that was put up so that we can start to put up the waterproofing that is on the exterior of the building. So this is going to go up for all the waterproofing, and then they're going to take this down and they'll put the skin on. So while this is up, we're putting waterproofing. This gives you an idea. You can sort of see through here, this yellow or greenish yellow, sort of like this color, greenish yellow is the waterproofing. So you can see that it's completed pretty much all the backside, and then they're moving along the sides with the waterproofing. So that's moving along really well. So you've got the interiors getting framed out, and you've got the exterior movement towards getting the skin on there also working and happening very timely. So with that, I'll take any questions.
When is the skin going to be up? When is it going to be waterproof so that when the rains come?
They're to start in September, and I think they have a time frame of, you know, quote unquote, being all done in January, but they anticipate being done by November. You know, okay. They think the majority of it should be
so
done by November.
Substantially waterproof by that time.
Yeah.
Oh, that's
yeah.
Wonderful. Oh, very good. Thank you very much, Ed.
Thank
any
you.
Questions for Ed? Oh. All right. Okay. Keep at it.
Thank you.
Looking forward to the opening. Quality report.
Yeah, we're going to ask Dr. Diane Martin to give this report tonight. She is our physician consultant in infectious disease. She became a member.
Nancy, I don't what? Think Diane is here.
She's
is
not
it?
Here?
Yeah, I think she is unable to make it from a last minute commitment. So.
Oh dear, I'm sorry. All right, we'll settle for you, Mary.
Okay, thank you.
It's hard shoes to fill, but I'll try. Okay. So what Dr. Martin wanted us to focus on tonight was, as you know, we've had a lot of efforts put into trying to prevent C. diff in the last couple of years. And we wanted to kind of look at that overall, what we've done and what we continue to hope to do moving forward. But just to take a step back and think about really what is C. diff. And it's a bacteria that is very common in our area, and it's you can pick it up by direct contact. Most people experience symptoms of a lot of diarrhea, fever, loss of appetite, nausea, abdominal pain. Those are most of the symptoms, but it typically comes for people who've had antibiotics recently, typically within the last 10 days. As I said, it's been transmitted through the environment. Direct contact is the most common way that patients pick it up. The reason why it's so important for us to focus on prevention right now is because it's become such an epidemic level right now, especially in Northern California. And it actually leads to about 7 to 15 days extra if you're in the hospital, if you acquire it while you're here taking antibiotics, and quite a bit in expenses, $4.8 billion. Typically in cost. So the rest of the nation is also continuing to focus on this. CDC has done a lot of work around prevention of C. diff, especially related to antimicrobial use. And that has led to basically them making the recommendation that it's best for all hospitals to focus on prevention instead of trying to treat it once your patient acquires it. So the way that we're trying to do that is through six areas, mostly looking at how we prescribe antibiotics, making sure we're prescribing them appropriately, that if a patient does come in and have diarrhea, that we recognize it right away, we get them isolated, we test early, we test and treat appropriately, and that we put them in contact precautions if they do have the symptoms of C. diff. And keeping our environment clean is another big focus that EVS has been working on last year, especially cleaning the environment with bleach in known patients, and not just everybody that we know that has C. diff, but patients that we think are suspect for having C. diff. Our committee, our infection prevention committee, has worked on this a lot in the last couple of years. I think we've talked about it here. About every quarter, we talk about some of the actions we're doing around C. diff, but we continue to work on renewing those efforts through evidence-based practice. We're always looking at the literature. Dr. Martin's always looking at the literature. We even go to the county, we go to the state to get recommendations frequently. They typically come about once a year and make recommendations for what we can do in the hospital to prevent C. diff. And these are just the members of our team, Dr. Martin, myself, Raquel Hoag, and Leah Stady. Because the state and the, even on a federal level, everybody wants to know exactly what's going on, even in a community hospital of our size, we have to report all the C. diff that is identified here by lab. We report it on a county level, on a state level, and on a federal level. And these are just the list of the groups that we report to. And that typically is about every quarter. This part is kind of what I mentioned before about the steps taken at Washington Hospital, what we've done to make sure that our house-wide initiative has been effective. And really with that, we've actually had some pretty good luck in the last year. We've been able to see a significant reduction, 67%. We've always had a higher than national average for about the last year and a half, but we were able to take all of the methods that I've discussed before and see that reduction, which has been really significant for us, especially even in high census earlier this year, we were able to see a decrease. But I think a lot of that has come from our antimicrobial stewardship, looking at really how we prescribe the antibiotics, making sure that we use the right antibiotics at the right time. And we've had a lot of support with that, working with the pharmacy. We've also had recently a great amount of support even from the board, and we appreciate this so much, is the approval for us to have a EPIC platform built in infection control. And that's basically, we have the latest and greatest software that EPIC has available to us to make sure that we can identify these patients effectively. And we get real-time reports, we can see them and know who they are in the hospital and make these interventions appropriately right away for them. That also has really helped. We're gonna go live with this software in November, and it's really going to help kind of get the infection preventionist behind the desk, which is where they are now doing a lot of this required data reporting, and out and back to the bedside so that they can round even more frequently. So we think the software will help us a lot. It's important for patients and family members to remember some things when they come into the hospital, one of which is, just like any other infection, you have to wash your hands, you know, anytime that, of course, before you eat, after you use the restroom. But when you're in the hospital, it's a little bit more of a high-risk environment. So washing your hands before and after entering any patient rooms, or for family members who are visiting patients, same exact thing. Always remember to be very vigilant about washing your hands while you're here at the hospital. And what we've tried to do with our C. diff patients, the ones that we know about, is we want them to be able to still get up and ambulate and do all those things that are appropriate for their care. But we try to keep them in sort of common established areas that are maybe more unit-based, and walk them, and we use gowns and appropriate personal protective equipment to make sure that we aren't spreading it further in the environment. We also have a policy where we'd like for any family members or visitors to check with the nursing staff prior to entering the room, because that gives us an opportunity to provide some education to the family members, and then they can take that education home and use it even when they're at home so that they can prevent further spread in their own houses. So again, it's just continuing to make sure that they are also, when they get home, keeping their surfaces clean in their homes so that that it's not spreading. The problem with C. diff is it lives in an environment for at least 60 days. So even when you bring somebody home and they have active diarrhea, it's very important to get in and keep all the bathrooms and bedding and everything extremely clean, because it's a spore that can get and live on the environments and spread significantly even once you get home. And of course, the same thing with any antibiotic prescription, making sure that you take the full dose that you're given is very important, especially in the treatment of C. diff. I know that one of the points that Dr. Martin and I had discussed is that it's essential for the community to understand when to use antibiotics, because what tends to happen is I think people come to their doctor and want to leave with a prescription. And so it's important to remember when you show up, even with a cold or your child has an earache or whatever the case may be, unless it's a bacterial infection and unless it's a bacterial infection that requires an antibiotic, it's not necessary all the time to give antibiotics. And that sometimes, you know, most of the time these things can be viruses and you can treat them appropriately without the overuse of antibiotics, which would further reduce the incidence of C. diff. Another common myth is people think that if they see green colored mucus, oh, I need antibiotics right away. And that is actually not the case also. And CDC has put out a lot of statements about this recently, and those do not necessarily always require an antibiotic. And also, you know, we don't want people to be taking antibiotics unless they absolutely need it, because anytime you take a prescription drug, there's associated risks with it. And in this case, the number one risk is typically acquiring C. diff. That's it. Any questions?
Thank you very much, Mary. It's good to see that we're making progress on this very challenging problem.
It is, yeah. It's been a big thing. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Finance report, Chris Henry.
Okay, so tonight I'll be reporting on Washington Hospital's operational and financial results for June 2016, the last month of our fiscal year 2016. And we'll move into operating indicators. Volumes were a little challenged in June. Average daily census ended up at 141.1. We'd expected 154.3. We had 956 admissions, about 58 lower than what we had expected. And our patient days came in at 4,232. We had expected 4,629 for June. These numbers are also off of last year, significantly off of last year's numbers as well. So, you know, it's trying to predict the flow of how the volume is going to come during the year. It came later last year and earlier this year. Outpatient observation equivalent days in June were 54 below the budget at 209, and our average length of stay was below budget by 0.18 at 4.39. We had expected 4.57. Moving into operating indicators, while the volume was lower, the case mix was high at 1.619. We had 7 fewer deliveries than we expected at 151. Our surgical cases were 11 below budget at 380. That included our joint replacement cases that came in 3 above budget at 136. Neurosurgical cases for the month were about 3 below budget at 27. Our cardiac surgical cases, 2 above budget at 11. And we're seeing that volume begin to grow over the last several months. So that's a good sign. Cath lab procedures for the month came in at 332. We had expected 410, so they continued slower than we expected. Outpatient visits were 698 below budget at 7,173. Largely came in the area of lab and imaging, and you know those numbers are impacted by the inpatient census when it's low. So we've got a little spillover there. Emergency room had 4,054 visits against a budget of 4,391, and while that's below budget, it's still very busy for those folks. Quick look at the cath lab activity for June. Really, peripheral vascular procedures dominated the activity at 52%, followed by cardiac at 24%, and our non-vascular IR at 20%. So a big month for vascular procedures. Looking at our full-time equivalents for the month, our productive FTEs were 60 below budget at 1169.4. So we were trying to flex down to the activity, Non-productive FTEs were 211 above budget at 38.3, so that's a good indicator that folks were getting out on vacation. Our total FTEs came in at 21.7 below the budget at 1380.4. Our FTEs per AOB came in 0.55 higher than we expected at 7.21, but we did have our magnet survey in June. So there was a lot of preparation going on for that, and we still managed to get our productive FTEs down pretty significantly. Year to date, those numbers came in very close to budget at 6.57 against a budget of 6.49. So I think year to date we did pretty well on managing our staff. So let's dive into the financials. For June, total patient revenue came in 5.3% below budget at $161,122,000. Our contractuals for the month came in lower than budget at 74.68. We expected 77.06. This is year end, and there are a few things going on here. For one, we received notification that we were going to receive an $823,000 payment from the hospital fee, from the California hospital fee. So we did book that in June. That's not something that we budget, because from year to year we're not quite sure if it's going to happen. So that was good. We did a year-end look at our RAC reserves, and the RAC program works on a rolling three-year basis. So we did drop off a year out of our RAC reserve. That brought that down significantly. And then we had just a general contractual true-up of about $800,000 at year-end. So those were the drivers on that. So we ended June with separate from contractuals, we did meet the first milestone in our Prime program. Prime, and I'm going to get it right this time, is the Public Hospital Redesign and Incentives in Medi-Cal program. This is the program that has been available to other public hospitals for quite some time. And in the new waiver, district hospitals were allowed into it. This is a pool of money that's provided by CMS and the state to drive changes in care in the system. And we have three programs going in it right now. The first milestone was to get our programs submitted and approved by both the state and CMS, and we did achieve that. So we did receive almost $1 million payment for that. So we end up with net operating revenue of $41,934,000, $2.7 million above the budget. Operating expenses came in very close to budget at $37,214,000. We've got some offsetting things going in there. Our salary and wages were higher than we expected. We did have some retroactive payments that were paid in June. Benefits actually came in below budget. This is a great story. You know, every year in June we do our actuarial studies on a number of things, and with the pension studies, because of some demographic changes in our data, but primarily because of the significant funding that you, the board, have authorized us to do into the pension plan, our unfunded liability dropped by $3.8 million, and our funded status moved from 80% to 84%. So we're headed in the right direction, and thank you very much for allowing us to do that for our employees. We also did have a pickup on our post-retirement benefit obligation. That's the bridge plan for our retirees and also some of the supplemental payments for Medicare. Of about $800,000, that was really, again, driven by demographic data. That was a good pickup in our benefits area. Purchase services came in significantly below, well, about $500,000 below budget. Largely that came in our hospitalist area. We had expected to have the observation hospitalists in-house at this time, and that's coming, and just not quite here. And we were lower with our IT consulting costs. Offsetting some of that, we were a little bit higher in our provision for bad debt and charity. We've been talking about seeing a bit of an increase in our private pay patients over the last several months, and now that's starting to roll into bad debt. But we ended the month with a very good operating bottom line of $4.7 million, $2.7 million above the budget. Non-operating income came in about $846,000 above the budget at $2.3 million, a little bit more than $2.3 million. We had a $1 million unrealized gain in our investments this month. That's been flipping back and forth, but I'm happy because we ended the year on the positive side of almost $1 million. So total bottom line for the month of $7 million, a little over $7 million. We had budgeted $3.5 million. So the month looks great. You know, quick run through the year-to-date numbers. You know, our operating patient revenue came in about 1.4% below budget at a bit over $2 billion. Contractuals came in a little bit lower than budget, but pretty darn close. So we ended up with net operating revenue just 0.2% below budget, about $956,000 at $476,232,000. Our operating expenses came in about $3 million below budget, less than 1%, it's pretty close. So we ended the year with an operating bottom line almost $2.4 million above the budget at $24,453,000. So really good performance this year. You know, this is a bottom line that a lot of hospitals would die for. We're very fortunate. We have very talented staff here. Very talented physicians. I am proud to be part of this organization that is able to generate these kinds of results. So, if there are any questions on June?
No, just one comment, Chris. I think it's important to communicate to all of our employees the improvement in the pension funding.
Yes.
Because that's very nice to see. And when we do that kind of communication, I think we should compare our institution to other institutions throughout California and show what a stark difference there is in the pension funding accomplishments that we have and the financial stability that we've been able to create for this institution and our employees. Yeah. I mean, we really are working hard to keep that promise.
Yeah, and you know, I think what a lot of folks don't understand is for years, not just district hospitals, but governmental pensions have been handled on a pay-as-you-go basis. There has been no money put aside for the future liabilities. This board and this institution, since long before I arrived on the scene, was committed to funding that pension and remains committed to funding that pension. And you know, it's clear how much we all care about our employees, you and Nancy and the rest of the organization. So
yeah,
I do make a point of citing the percentage of funding CalPERS has versus ours. And
how bad is CalPERS these
they're
days?
47.3%.
Right. And Washington Hospital is
at 84.
Right.
Yeah, and I do make a point of telling them, because I think they benefit from knowing that the board of directors has looked out for them and has provided for them. And in a thousand different ways that shows up, but when you're here every day, sometimes you don't notice it. The parking garage has created quite a lot of discussion. The employees, when they got in there, were delighted with how light it is at night. We've heard remarks that they're not afraid to go out there because it's brilliantly lit, and they deeply appreciate that. They love being able to park indoors out of the elements and all the other niceties that have been put there. But I think one of the things they most deeply appreciate, which gets glossed over, is that we're one of the few hospitals that don't charge their employees for parking. And at other institutions not too far from us across the bay, the parking fees are substantial. And if you're at the lower end of the wage and salary scale and you're paying $800 a month to park.
Not 800, 800 a year.
No.
800 a month to park?
I think so, yeah.
It's a year.
One of our employees told us
Chris,
that.
Chris
it's
says
900
a year.
And I think it's at one of our across the bay it's $984 a year.
Yeah, I heard about 80, okay. 80, 80 bucks a month to park okay. in some of the yeah. other hospitals.
Then so, I got that wrong. But they don't have to
but
pay.
But 80 bucks
that
in
fee.
Your pocket is still every month is real yeah, money.
It is. And I think the closer you park to the institution, mm-hmm. the higher you pay.
Mm-hmm.
And they're delighted. They really are. And I do tell them what the board has done with their pensions.
Good.
It's a good story. It's mm-hmm.
All right.
Okay,
Nancy,
we ready to look at July?
Yeah, yeah. Let's see what the how the new year is coming.
Well, the new year got off to a slow start.
Right.
We were below budget by 3.6% in terms mm-hmm. of our gross revenue. We had gross revenue come in at $158 million and $5.9 million under budget. The inpatient gross revenue came in at $115.5 million or 4.9% below budget. The outpatient gross revenue was down by $1 million. The major drivers of the unfavorable revenue variance came from variety of areas. One is surgical volume, which was below budget by 8.7%. So our surgical services revenue came in $2.5 million below budget. There were a lot of people that were away on vacation and didn't get back until closer towards the end of the month when volume starts to take off again. Let's see, respiratory therapy was down by $1 million. Ancillary services was down by 1.6. And the July pharmacy numbers are in 4.2% down. So our patient days were 2.9 below budget. Cath lab volume was below budget by 2.9% as well. Our activity was lower than anticipated overall, but the census surgical volume started to pick up in the third week of July and began tracking much closer to budget in that time. I have a small note that in that last week or so, we did 6 cardiac surgeries. I think it's people recovered from their 4th of July hiatus, then volume started to resume closer to normal. Admissions of 943 came in above budget, 0.5%. The average length of stay was lower than expected, so our patient days went down below budget, and they were 2.9% down. Our admissions trend continued to stick fairly close to the budget, and they were just 1.4% lower than July a year ago. The increases in general medical product line accounted for the variance in the admissions. So it wasn't from surgery, it wasn't from cardiac, it was general medical admissions. Our patient days trend is slightly below budget, 5.6% lower than a year ago. The patient days came even lower than we had expected. It isn't just the number of admissions, it's the length of stay. The surgical cases in July numbered 368. They were 35 cases below budget. Our inpatient surgeries were 15 below budget. The outpatient surgeries were 20 below budget. The major surgical variance drivers included cardiac surgeries that came in above budget by 5, general surgical cases that were below budget by 32, and that's where you see the vacations beginning to take an effect. The joint replacement cases were also below budget, but this time only by 5. And then again, that's very much related to vacation time. The neurosurgical cases were below budget by 3. The cath lab procedures for July numbered 363, and they were just 11 cases below budget. The cath lab activity for peripheral vascular were under budget by 37. The non-vascular IR procedures were below budget by 15. We had one of our doctors on vacation for 2 weeks. The neuro
IR procedures were below budget by only one. And this was offset by cardiac procedures that came in above budget by 42. And of note are the PTCAs. We had 41, bringing us in above budget by 5.1%. The deliveries for July numbered 137. They were below budget by 10. Non-emergency outpatient visits of 6,703 were under budget by 312 cases. Radiology visits were below budget by 96. Lab visits were below budget by 79. Cardiac rehab visits were below budget by 65. In terms of our productivity indicators, our productive FTEs were below budget by 48.4. This is a 4% variance. Non-productive FTEs were above budget by 37.8. Total FTEs of 1,371.3 were below budget by 10.6. Our productive FTEs for adjusted occupied bed of 6.0 was 1.7% below budget. The total FTEs for adjusted occupied bed of 7.16 was 1.7 above budget. Other operational statistics of interest include our surgery center. They had 462 cases in July. This was 23 cases below the budget. Our clinic visits for the month were 3,300, and they were just 2.6% lower than budget. Washington Urgent Care came in down by 85 visits, Newark 21, Nakamura 6, so they're very close to being spot on. Warm Springs 33, and the Ohlone Clinic a negative 10. That's a student health center clinic. Our payer mix is favorable in July. The government-sponsored patient revenue made up 69.6% of total gross revenue. We had budgeted 70.8. The PPO revenue was 24.3% of our gross revenue, which is above the budget. Private pay revenue is 2.6% of gross revenue compared to a budget of 2.1. And finally, our key financial statistics. Days cash on hand at July 31st was 221, down by 2 days from June. But we had expected a reduction of as many as 10 days cash on hand in July because we had principal and interest payments to make on our bonds. Our strong cash collections drove a better than expected result. So this is truly the work of financial services in achieving that kind of statistic. Our days in accounts receivable were 61. And at the end of the month, there were $868,815 of charity care applications pending for approval.
Thank you. Nancy, when is our dedicated observation unit expected to open?
This fall.
Okay, good. Thank you. All right. We have a single action item today, and that will be presented by Dr. Stewart.
Mr. President, I move for adoption of resolution number 1171, which will provide for the renovation and relocation of the Fremont Clinic for an amount not to exceed $1,626,528. Also, in accordance with district law policies and procedures, I move for the approval of this project to include the authorization by the Secretary of the Board of Directors to accept bids for the relocation of the Washington Urgent Care from firms that have been pre-qualified to bid on WHHS projects as a result of publicly advertised pre-qualification process.
So we have a motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
Second from Director Danielson. Nancy, can you elaborate on this?
When we first put the Urgent Care Center here at Washington West, we put it at the head of the land bridge on this building, believing that the land bridge would be a major artery
for a communication between the two buildings. It never worked out that way. And so it's sitting up on the second floor of this building, kind of isolated in a corner. And particularly during the evening hours, there are people wandering around in this very large building looking for the clinic. And it's not easy for them to find it. So we thought that it would be better for the clinic and better for our patients if we're on the ground floor, where they would expect to find it, and that would have its own entrance off of the parking lot. And so all of those things are going to be put into place with this project, and it will be readily accessible to the public.
Accessible and visible.
Yeah.
Right. I think those are wonderful, wonderful objectives.
I'm very excited to see that move. That's been...
I am too. It's been a long time.
Yeah. Yeah. Any other comments?
Very, very needed.
Yeah.
It has to be very, very visible, and I like the way the plans are working out.
Good. Jacob, any comments? Okay. Let's get it done. Christine, let's call the roll.
Director Nicholson?
Aye.
Director Stewart?
Aye.
Director Danielson?
Aye.
Director Epen?
Aye.
Great. Motion passes. Thank you.
Thank you.
Let's move that urgent care. At this point, we're going to adjourn to a closed session. We're going to reconvene to open session and announce that no reportable action was taken in the closed session. And there being no further business before this board, this meeting is adjourned. Thank you.